Remind you also of the soup kitchen, missions, the regular offering, all that's out there. I got notes here. Happy Father's Day. Isn't that awesome? Praise God. Paul, I was reading that in 1 Corinthians 4:15, and how Paul said, though you've had 10,000 instructors or teachers, yet you have not many fathers. For indeed, I have begotten you in the gospel. He wasn't saying that he was the agent of them being born again, but he was saying, I fathered you. How many know just because someone gives physical birth as the physical father of someone doesn't mean they're necessarily a father? Amen. There's more to it than just that. Amen. Praise the Lord. All right. Meliska, I got her ticket. Boy, I even wrote on my hand, Meliska. Where's she at? Wrote on my hand trying to remember nursery. So this is not dirt. All right. Okay. I want to say this also. I guess we'll get started because I want to read something to you. I think I have it here on my phone. We'll see. Okay, there it is. This morning, I did run this morning. I don't run every morning. I try to run 4 times a week, 5 miles. Long story short, so I ran this morning. I'm running in Greenville, Ohio, little Greenville, Ohio. And I'm running on North Broadway. And all of a sudden I go, whoa, whoa, whoa. From here to that chair, there's a skunk. And this skunk's going like this, just watching me in town. I mean, it was a cute little skunk, but believe me, I knew it wasn't a kitty. You remember our gang? Here, kitty, kitty, kitty. Anyhow, and that really woke me up, believe me. You know, like, I'm like Jason, you know, you're jogging and gliding along 60, 70 mile an hour, weaving in and out of traffic. That's a joke. You're going so slow. No, not him, maybe me. But this is another one, too. I got to tell you this story. How many know it's good to laugh? Amen. A merry heart does good like a medicine, the scripture says. But look at this. That Joel Barhorst, our son, baby Joel, Julie calls him. We have a bay window in the back, and it's been 2-3 weeks ago. Joel was killing a fly with his hand, and the window went Shazam. And I wasn't real happy with that. And that's why we have fly swatters, Joel. But this is so amazing. This is, and Dave Levy's on it, so we're hoping to have our put the new window in when it comes in. But it's, of course, it's all got the plastic over and all that stuff. And no, we don't. And so Shirley Levy, Dave's wife, wrote a poem about Joel. This is hilarious. Ready? The night and the fly. How loathsome was the buzzing pest, the germy, filthy fly. It zoomed into the castle and circled low and high. The young knight of this fair abode rose quickly to the fight. I will dispatch the gruesome beast as long as there is light. It was a worthy match of foes, a strategy of wits. The fly maneuvered like an ace. The warrior swung his fist. It was an epic battle. They quarreled, spun, and tore. The insect opted for escape. The lad chased all the more. Until at last a window bright called to the fly to land. The zealous youth, both brave and strong, then smacked it with his hand. Our hero Joel stood in the midst of victory, short but sweet. For remnants of the window pane lay scattered at his feet. The humble knight took counsel and agreed that he would try to next time find a swatter when contending with a fly. Shirley Levy, isn't that awesome? I thought that was awesome. You know what I know? If we need to, even when we go through negative situations, you need to start saying, Lord, how are you going to turn this around for my good? How are you going to turn this around? I've seen that work many times. But it's amazing how we forget. I talked to Greg Moore recently, and we were talking about different things. And I said, Greg, nobody is beyond deception. Nobody. And you know what Greg said? That's why we need each other. That's why we need the body. I thought that was so profound. Anyhow, praise the Lord. Let's get right into this because we've got a lot to go and a very short time to do it. Glory to God. I'm excited about the Word of God. This is part two. We've been doing a series on the covenant, obviously, which is the whole Bible. Jesus is our covenant with God. And you know that you and I are ready, are called to partake of the benefits of a perfectly kept covenant with God through Jesus. That's exciting. That's why if your outward circumstances aren't going good, you can still praise the Lord. Amen. I just think that's amazing. All right, this is part two of the covenant rep and the covenant steps. We won't get into the steps this week, but I'm hoping next week that will be what happens. I need to review. Everybody say review. Review is good, all right? Last week I talked about glorying in our personal weakness is foundational to receiving the Lord's strength. 2 Corinthians chapter 12, verses 9 and 10. To glory in my personal weakness, recognizing my personal weakness. I felt like the Lord put it on my heart recently that people need a revelation of the earthen vessel. People need to know that outside of Christ, you have got nothing. You know why God gave the law? It was to show us that we have nothing. I've said it like this. I know he gave it to one nation, but it condemned the whole world. I got that. But if you don't, I've said it often, you don't go in your attic that's dark and turn on the light and then think the light brought all the dirt and dust and all that. No, the light merely reveals what's there. And see, and the Bible says in Jeremiah 17:9 that the heart, the human heart, is deceitful above all things and desperately wicked. Who can know it? Think of it this way. Imagine, have you ever seen water, real clear, fresh water, and you look down and you can see the bottom? You ever seen that? And you look down and say, man, that water is really clean, right? And then somebody takes a stick and they go down to the bottom and stir up the mud. Now, you know, the water's not clean now. The stick is the law. And man looks and he thinks, man, I'm really good. And then God gives the law. That's why Paul said, I would have not known lust except the law had said, thou shalt not covet. In other words, I was doing pretty good with the first nine commandments. And then it says, you shouldn't even want to do this. Wow, that gets every one of us, right? But see, people think, and even Christians, without God, I'm a zero with the rim knocked off. I mean, and I really, you got to come to the end of yourself, I believe, before you really get to the beginning of God. You got to have a revelation that, man, outside of Christ, I really am nothing. But that's not a condemning thing. That's an exciting thing, because now, once you're an empty vessel, God can begin to fill an empty vessel with who he is. See, but so many people think that, well, God gave us these rules. We got to keep the rules. That's what they think Christianity is. That's why God's not exciting to them. If I could keep the rules, the cross was unnecessary. And this is why the role of the Holy Spirit's so powerful. I have to show you a verse. This isn't in your outline. This is a verse I seen on that porcelain seat we have in a room in our house. All right, let me show it to you. Ready? It's in Hebrews chapter 10. And this, I was reading Hebrews 10 the other day, which I always try to read the word first thing in the morning. And I was, because I want to get my mind in the right direction. And I was reading this, and I was reading Hebrews chapter 10. And you know, let's just look at verse 14. And then I'm going to show you verse 15. Because verse 15 is what jumped at me. I've shared this verse I don't know how many times. This is an amazing, amazing, the whole book of Hebrews is amazing. But this is so powerful. By one offering, this is referring to the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. He has perfected, which means made complete, forever, those, you and I, that are sanctified or set apart. Now here's the verse that got me. Go to the next verse. Whereof the Holy Ghost also is a witness to us, for after that he said before. Now leave that up there. Notice who makes that real. The Holy Spirit. Without the Holy Spirit, we're just interpreting the Bible with our intellect, which equates to all kinds of division. But see, you can't receive the ministry of the Holy Spirit if you're still glorying in what you think you know. The 1 Corinthians 8 says, if you think you know anything, you don't know anything as you ought to know. It didn't say you didn't know anything. It says you don't know it as you should. How should you? You need to approach it with humility and say, Lord, I need the Holy Spirit. I need the Holy Spirit. I can't do anything without the Holy Spirit. I can't understand the Bible without the Holy Spirit. Neither can you. Next verse. This is powerful. Look at this. Who makes the covenant real? This is the covenant that I will make with them after those days, saith the Lord. I will put my laws into their hearts, and in their minds will I write them. Isn't that amazing? God didn't do away with the law. He merely relocated the law. Now instead of being on tablets of stone or on a plaque in the courthouse, now they're in your heart. Amen? One more verse. Maybe more. I don't know. And their sins and iniquities I will remember no more. Now keep going. It's all good. Now where remission or release of these is, there's no more offering for sin. That's why doing penance and doing all these things is insane. It's antichrist. There's no more offering for sin. Isn't that good news? Hallelujah. Keep going. Having therefore, brethren, boldness. Now that's a powerful word. It's translated confidence in 1 John chapter 5, but it's boldness. Parisia, it means a faith that speaks up. You talk the walk. You declare, you praise God. Having therefore, brethren, boldness to enter into the holiest by the blood of Jesus, not your merit, not your goodness, not your intellect, not what I think I know, but by the blood of Jesus. Amen. Keep going. By a new and living way, which he hath consecrated for us through the veil, that is to say his flesh. Next verse. And having an high priest, a representation over the house of God, we have representation before God. His name is Jesus. Glory to God. Next verse. Let us draw near. Let us draw near. Let us draw near in full assurance of faith. Faith has to have the correct object. Legalism makes you the object of your faith. True faith makes Jesus the object of your faith. That's why we can draw near, watch this, with full assurance of faith, if our faith is in the correct object. Glory to God. The reason people aren't sure, the reason they don't speak up is because they're not looking fully at Jesus. They're looking at their performance or lack thereof. Having our, oh, this is so good. Having our hearts sprinkled. You know, in the Old Testament, they would sprinkle the altar. They would sprinkle the different parts of the tabernacle. They would sprinkle these things with the blood. Sprinkle, amen? Having our hearts sprinkled from an evil conscience. What is an evil conscience? A conscience that won't draw near because it's looking at self instead of him. And our bodies, it affects our bodies. Washed with pure water, referring to the water of the word. Keep going. I wasn't planning on doing this. Let us hold fast. This is so good. Let us hold fast. Let us hold fast our confession, profession, homologia in Greek, which means to say the same thing. It means to speak to a conclusion. This is praise and worship. When you praise God for, you know, I was praising God the other day for meeting our needs. Anybody ever done that lately? Don't look, I'm not asking you to answer. It's between you and God. When do we pray? God is so good to us. What you're seeing in our society now is a bunch of spoiled brats who need the Lord. They don't know what they have. They don't know how good this country is. I love what Ramin says. He says America, he's been all over the world. America's the most non-racist country on the planet. But yet the demons are stirring up this garbage to divide us. That's Satan's strategy, divide and conquer. The church needs to be smarter. I don't care what color your skin is. I could care less. Like Dr. Martin Luther King said, it's the condition of the heart, not the color of the skin. It's not a skin problem, it's a sin problem. People need the Lord. It's not about race, it's about grace. All those cute little sayings, amen? But let us hold fast to our confession of our faith in him without wavering, for he is faithful that has promised. See, the Holy Spirit's the one that makes this all real. That's what jumped at me. Verse 15. A few more. And let us consider one another to provoke. See, there's the brotherly covenant here. To provoke unto love and to good works. The word provoke means to stimulate. It means to irritate. I call it holy irritation. One more verse and then we'll stop here. Not forsaking the assembling of ourselves together as the manner of some is, but exhorting one another, encouraging one another, and so much the more as you see the day approaching. I'm telling you, the day is approaching. People can say what they will. And there's a bunch of, almost said nitwits, but I caught myself. There's a bunch of people teaching that, well, Jesus returned in 70 AD and we're in a new world. No, we're not. The new covenant was available after the cross and in our spirit. That's a reality, but we're in a broken world. And 1 John 5:19 says the whole world lies in wickedness. Aren't we seeing that? But we need, that's why we need each other. We need to encourage one another. We need to pray for one another. We need to build each other up. This is all part of covenant understanding. So we need to glory in our personal weakness. While we're there, go to Hebrews 11:1. I want to show you something. Faith's object must be Jesus. And we'll get into the covenant representative. Look at this. Now faith, somebody say now faith, is the substance of things hoped for. It's the evidence of things not seen. Now stop. I want to say something here. I know there's teachings on now faith. I'm not saying there's not elements of truth there, but this is not saying that. This is saying in the new covenant, where it was works under the old covenant, in the new covenant, now it's faith. Faith in Jesus and what he's done. Can you hear that? Now, in this new covenant, it's faith in someone else and not me. Hallelujah. You know, even under the law of Moses, they couldn't keep the covenant. That's why there were animal sacrifices. Whenever a covenant's broken, someone has to die. Did you know that? Nobody knew that, okay? That's why Jesus had to die. That's why you don't pay the price for your sins. He did it. That's why we can rejoice right now. That's why we can say the same thing about us that he says about us. Because if you're born again, I'm the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. Well, I know you, Chris. You sure don't act like it. It's not about how I act. I've received Jesus by faith, and I rejoice in that. And if I really believe it, it'll change how I act, and it won't be an act. Amen. It'll be the fruit of who I am. All right. So faith's object must be Jesus. Few more. First John, go to Revelation 21:7, quick. And then I'm going to quote 1 John 5:4. This is the victory, 1 John 5:4, that overcomes the world, the cosmos, the disordered order because of sin. This is the victory, even our faith. Think about that. This is the victory. See, we've made faith everything but what faith is sometimes. Faith is the object of a person who's faithful. I was thinking of 1 Thessalonians 5:24 just this morning in my office, and I was thinking, faithful is he that calls you, who also will do it. You know what faith is? Faith is putting my faith in his faithfulness. Faith is not about my faithfulness. It's about his. Oh, glory to God, that's good news. For years I thought it was, well, I just got to be faithful. I got to do this. I got to do that. No, you put your faith in his faithfulness, and you will be faithful. You know the key to not giving up on God? Is a revelation that he'll never give up on you. Glory. People that give up on God have believed somewhere in their heart that he's had it with them, or he's given up on them, or, well, I ain't doing this or that. That's why you got to feed on the Lamb. You got to feed on Jesus. That's what the Holy Spirit does. He exalts Jesus. Whew. He that overcometh. What overcomes the world? 1 John 5:4. Our faith in him. Now it's faith in the new covenant. In the old covenant was works. In the new covenant, it's faith. He that overcometh shall inherit. Wait a minute. If overcoming was something like I had to earn it, then inherit would be an inaccurate word. But he's saying, by putting my faith in him, I inherit all things. And I will, and look at this, it says, and I will be his God. Wait a minute, I thought he already was my God. It's talking about inaction. And he shall be my son. It's talking about power. These are, see, are you... We don't inherit things. We inherit God. First, I'm going to show it to you so you know I'm not a heretic. Galatians chapter 4, verse 7. Watch this. This is mind-boggling to people. The very fact that people think, when you say the word prosperity, people in America, in the Western culture, they automatically think of stuff. You can have lots of stuff and be very poor. It's about what has you. Sometimes prosperity is not is being content with less. No matter what you have, you've learned to abound. And as I said earlier, God wants us to prosper, but it's for the kingdom. How many of you are believing for more so you can give more? When God gets a hold of your heart, this is how you think. This is why God wants to expand us so we can make a bigger difference in this world. How many know the world needs what you got? They're hurting for what you got. So many of these kids out there protesting, they don't even know what they're doing. Wow. Wherefore thou art no more a servant, referring to the old covenant, but a son, glory to God. And if a son, then an heir of the things of God through Christ. It doesn't say that. It says you're an heir of God. That sounds like blasphemy to people. It's not. It's covenant. Contracts deal with things. Covenant deals with people, with beings. I'm his. I'm not my own. I'm bought with a price, 1 Corinthians 6:20 and 7:23. I don't belong to me. I belong to him. I'm his property, but he belongs to me. The God of Abraham. And if you're Christ, then you're Abraham's seed and heirs according to the promise. I'm trying to get you to hear with circumcised ears and understand what a circumcised heart is all about. That's why throughout the Old Testament, you hear David saying stuff like, my God, my strong tower, my strength. You hear the my? Remember we did that message, my? Hey, my. That's not what we're talking about. That was a flashback. I'm doing okay. All right. Face object must be him. All right, now, that's review. Number two, look at number two. And go to Ezekiel chapter 22. Ezekiel 22, watch this. There was a need because Adam sinned. Adam was the representation of all mankind. Did you know that? And in Adam, we were all born into sin. You don't teach a little child how to do wrong. They already know that, right? You teach them how to do right. This brings up the question. If a baby dies before the law of accountability, they go straight to heaven, okay? But they automatically know how to do wrong. The need for a man to represent a man. Look at the people of the land have used oppression and exercised robbery and have vexed the poor and needy. Yea, they have oppressed the stranger wrongfully. This is not good. Next verse. And I sought for a man among them. Their man must be represented by man. Through Adam, all fell short of the glory of God. Keep your finger there. Some of you are wondering, I'm trying to see if you're awake. Keep your finger there. Come right back there and go over to Hosea 6:7 from the New American Standard, and we'll come right back here. We talked about, like Adam, the King James and the New King James say, man, they have transgressed the covenant. There they have dealt treacherously against me. Now go back to Ezekiel 22, King Jimmy. Watch this. So it was violated through Adam, so there needed to be a man to represent man. Back to Ezekiel 22, thank you. And I sought for a man among them that should make up the hedge and stand in the gap. What was the gap? Between God and man. Genesis 6:3 was prophesied, my spirit shall not always strive with man. Look at this. To make up the hedge, stand in the gap before me for the land that I should not destroy it. Notice what he sought for, a man. Go to 31 and we'll come back to verse 30. Therefore have I poured out my indignation upon them. I have consumed them with the fire of my wrath. Their own way have I recompensed upon their heads, saith the Lord. Go back to verse 30. And I sought for a
man.
You could see the same thing. I'm not going there for the sake of time, but it's in your outline. Isaiah 59, 12 through 17. Now go to John chapter 19, verse 5. Not in your outline. You can write though. Then came Jesus forth, wearing the crown of thorns and the purple robe, and Pilate saith unto them, behold the man. You see it? Now jump over to 1 Timothy 2:5. Some of these aren't your outline. For there is one God, three persons, God the Father, God the Son, and Holy Spirit. It doesn't bring it out here, but there's one God and one mediator or go-between between God and man. The man, Christ Jesus. Go to John 5:27. Look at this. Talking about Jesus and how God hath given him authority to execute judgment also because he is the Son of God. That's what people think. The Son of Man. You see that? That's big. There was a need for man to represent man before God. Go to Hebrews chapter 5, verse 1. Hebrews chapter number 5 and verse 1. The high priest, I've told you this before, represented man before God. The high priest was our representation. That's why under the old covenant, if the high priest was good and the people were bad, the people were still blessed. If the people were good and the high priest was bad, the people were cursed. It's based on your representation. Look at this. For every high priest or representative taken from among men, Jesus became a man, is ordained for men in things pertaining to God that he may offer both gifts and sacrifices for sin. Notice, taken from among men, for men in things pertaining to God. This is our representation. Now, go to Job. Job 16:21. Job chapter 16 and verse 21. Job. Go to the book of Job. Job's crying out. You know, people make the book of Job so hard. It's not hard. Job did not have a covenant with God like you and I do. You understand that? He wasn't a new covenant guy. Most theologians believe the book of Job is the oldest book in the Bible. I'm not here to say, but Job basically was in Satan's authority and Satan didn't know it, which brings up something interesting. Satan is not omniscient. Satan doesn't know. Satan's not organized like you think. His kingdom is a kingdom of disorder. See, we make the devil so powerful. He's so defeated. He wants you to think he's powerful. That's why he's a good liar, because that's all he's got. That's why I tell people all the time, even when you sin, you do not give the devil authority. You can give him place, but not authority, and there's a huge difference. Job's crying out, and you know, his three friends, I've been meditating on Job's three friends, Eliab and Bildad and Zophar, and how man, what jerks. You know, I'm sorry. Well, no, I'm not. They're jerks. They were. And man, they're just slamming Joel in the corner. And Job says, man, I could speak like you guys, if with the roles were reversed here, I could talk to you like that. But Job, rather than throwing himself and saying, okay, you know, whatever, I'm trusting God. I'm putting my faith in God. Job started defending himself. And he says, I think it's in Job 27, I'm going to hold on to my righteousness. I'm right before God. I'm right. He should have said, Lord, he should have threw his hands up and cried for mercy. At the end of the book, Job repents. Amen. So the book of Job, basically, here it is. Oh, that one might plead for a man with God. He's crying out for a mediator. You see that? As a man pleadeth for his neighbor. Job's saying, I don't have anybody to plead my case before God. Guess what? Jesus did that for you and I. Oh, my. That's why when it says he's at the right hand of the Father making intercession for us, he's representing us. He obtained for us by hitting the mark. That's exciting. All right. Job's cry. When Israel, now this is what happened under the old covenant. Go to Exodus 24. No, let me say this one. Jump over to Isaiah 45, verse 7. I'm going to give you some quick verses here. Isaiah chapter 45. Look what God says. I form the light and create darkness. I make peace and create evil. I, the Lord, do these things. What? God creates evil? I thought it says, let no man say when he's tempted, I'm tempted of God. This is talking about judgment. Israel had to experience judgment when they broke the covenant. Did you know that? That's what God's saying. I have to judge it. Now, I'm going to show you another one. Go to Amos 3:6. Amos 3:6, I think. Yes. Shall a trumpet be blown in the city and the people not be afraid? Shall there be evil in a city and the Lord hath not done it? What is he talking about? He's not saying God's bad and he decides he's talking about the judgment because they broke the covenant. Let me show you their mistake. Everybody say their mistake. Exodus 24, verse 3. Here it is. Here's their mistake. They put faith in their ability to keep the covenant rather than God's ability. And you and I, see, this is where people, Christians, New Covenant Christians, they think God gave a law so they could somehow keep it. You can't keep it. There's only one that could keep it. And the harder you try, many times you just stir up sin rather than putting your faith in him. And Moses came and told the people all the words of the Lord and all the judgments, and all the people answered with one voice and said, all the words which the Lord has said, we will do. When they said, well, let me show it to you again. Go to verse 7, same chapter. Watch this. Everything you say. And he took the book of the covenant and read it in the audience of the people. And they said again, all that the Lord has said, we will do. In other words, we can do it, God. Piece of cake. We can, everything you command us, we can do it. This is where many people are. They think, well, I'm a pretty good person. Who wants to be the best sinner that ever went to hell? Listen, if you've even sinned one time, if you keep the whole law and yet offend in one point, you're guilty of the whole thing, James 2:12. But we have to keep our dependence in him and out of us. That's the good fight of faith. That's the labor to rest. That's why it's good news. You know why it's good news? Because it's about what he did for me and as me and not about me. That makes it good news. So many people are up and down. They're like emotional yo-yos because they think, well, God's ticked at me this time. God loves me this time. God loves you. If you're in his son, God looks at you and says, I'm pleased. Oh, glory to God. Judgment and death is the consequence of a covenant violation. Judgment and death. Jump over to, I'll just do Isaiah 24, 4 through 6. Look at this. No, make it 4, if you don't mind. The earth mourneth and fadeth away. The world languisheth and fadeth away. The haughty people of the earth do languish. Next verse. The earth also is defiled unto the inhabitants thereof because they have transgressed the laws, changed the ordinance, and broken the everlasting covenant. How did they break the covenant? Through Adam. You know, when you look at a tree and you see it half dead, you know what that is? The curse that Adam brought into this earth. The Bible says in 1 Corinthians 15, the last enemy that shall be destroyed is death. All forms of death, physical death, it's going to be destroyed completely. But you and I that have received Jesus in our spirit, we have the very life of Christ. Amen. Hang on. All right. Outside of the covenant is death. Look at Leviticus chapter 10, verses 1 and 2. What kind of time are we looking at? I got a lot to go. And Nadab and Abihu, is how I pronounce it, the sons of Aaron, took either of them his censer and put fire therein and put incense there on it. Now watch this. And offered strange fire before the Lord. What is strange fire? One of the definitions is it's adulterous fire. What does it say in James 4? You adulterers and adulteresses. Don't you know that friendship with the world, you make yourself the enemy of God? And he's talking to believers. Believers that approach on their ability to be right with God instead of putting faith in his ability, Jesus' ability that has made you right with God, it's adultery in the eyes of God. Now, he's not going to reject you, but he is going to correct you because he loves you. There's a sin unto death, and then there's a sin not unto death. One of them you pray for, the other one you teach people to relate to God based on Jesus. You know, I only have one message. You do know that. You do know that. It's called Jesus Christ and Him Crucified. Every message I teach here is coming at that from a different angle. And when you discover the power of the one message, you'll never run out of messages. When I listen to somebody, I listen. Are they exalting Jesus or are they exalting their performance? Are they exalting Jesus or are they exalting their intellect? Are they bragging on Jesus or are they boasting in themselves? Hallelujah. Glory to God. So look at that. They offered strange fire. Now look what happened. Go to verse 2. And there went out a fire from the Lord and devoured them, and they died before the Lord. Under the new covenant, we're not going to die, but when we offer strange fire, we experience death in certain areas. What is death? Separation from God. When I do things in my own way, and I say, no, the word says this, but I'm going to do it this way, there's a death in that. All right, Proverbs 13:13, you made me. Watch this. I'm trying to hurry. Whoso despiseth the word shall be destroyed. And that word for despise means to regard it as insignificant. God loves you. That's why he's having me say these things. Because he loves us. We need to constantly judge ourselves, 2 Corinthians 13:5, to make sure our faith is in Jesus and not in us. You know, God really blessed me recently with some very, very encouraging words from people that I really, really respect. And I was just, it just humbled me. And I'm thinking, Lord, I'm almost afraid of myself. Does that make any sense to anybody? I don't want to start thinking. Never believe your own press. Only believe Jesus' press. I heard a thing one time. They talking to Tom Brady after the New England Patriots won their first Super Bowl. And they say, you want to win another one? Don't believe the press. Don't believe your own press. Work hard. Thank you. Oh, praise God. So look at this. But he that fears the commandment, honors the word, reverences the word, shall be rewarded. Glory to God forevermore. All right. Outside of the covenant is death. Look at this. How many know but Jesus paid the price and took our death? I'm going to talk to you a little bit about the vine of the earth. Ready? The vine of the earth and the winepress of the wrath of God. Yes, I'm getting into the book of Revelation. Uh-oh. You know the revelation of Jesus Christ is about Jesus Christ? Isn't that awesome? Look at this. Revelation 14, verses 19 through 20. I'm going to do this quick because I want to finish this outline. And the angel thrust in his sickle into the earth and gathered the vine of the earth. Everybody say the vine of the earth. How many of you know that John chapter 15, Jesus said, I am the true vine and my Father is the vine dresser, the husbandman, right? We're the branches. Who's the vine of the earth? Amen. And gathered the vine of the earth and cast it into the great winepress of the wrath of God. My breaking of the covenant through Adam deserved the wrath of God. That's why the wrath of God, Jesus said, John 3:36, abides or lives on those who don't believe. Believe in what? In him and what he did. But see, people have this idea that, well, I'm just going to try harder. I'm just going to get better. Flesh never gets better. It never gets better. We only think it does. But just let that stick come down in that clear water and stir up the mud on the bottom. I would never. Don't. Look at this. Outside of. So he gathered the vine of the earth, cast into the great winepress of the wrath of God. Next verse. And the winepress. If you can't see Jesus here. The winepress was trodden without the city. What's that talking about? Jesus was crucified outside the city. Golgotha, Calvary, right? On a hill. This is talking about Jesus. And blood came out of the winepress, even under the horse bridles. Oh, I got all this stuff. By the, it's all right here. This is so good. By the space of 1,600 furlongs. We'll get to that. So the vine of the earth, Jesus, right? Cast into the great winepress of the wrath of God. I'm going to show you this. Isaiah 54, verse 7. Isaiah chapter 54 and verse 7. For a small moment, this is talking about Jesus, have I forsaken thee. Now, you know, there's another teaching going on that says God never forsook Jesus. First of all, why are you saying that nitwit stuff? Jesus said on the cross, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? God forsook Jesus so he could legally never forsake you and I. That's good news. And they make a big deal out of this. There's people teaching the earth is flat. There is. That's a big teaching. I had a pastor friend of mine, Jimmy Miller from Greenville, South Carolina, got a hold of me. He said, have you heard of this flat earth thing? I said, oh yeah, here we go again. Complete and utter nonsense. Four corners of the earth. These are some of the things they say. For a small moment, but with great mercies will I gather thee. Next verse. Got to hurry. In a little wrath, I hid my face from thee for a moment, but with everlasting kindness will I have mercy on thee, saith the Lord thy Redeemer. Next verse. For this is as the waters of Noah unto me, for as I have sworn that the waters of Noah should no more go over the earth, so have I sworn that I would not be wroth with thee, nor rebuke thee. Next verse. For the mountain shall depart, and the hill shall be removed, but my covenant loyalty, my kindness shall not depart from thee, neither shall the covenant of my peace. What is that talking about? Romans 5:1, therefore being justified or declared righteous by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. I am right with God. That'll put a shout in a telephone pole. I am blessed. Oh, Chris, we look at you and all we see is athleticism. I try so hard to be serious and then people make fun of me. Jason, help me out, brother. No, but seriously, you look at yourself. That's Satan's ploy to get you to look at you instead of him. You see these things in yourself and you think, oh, why is this in me? You're not looking at him. That's an indicator. When the oil light is going on in your car, put some oil in it. Who's the oil? The Holy Ghost. Get in the Word and let him open the Word up to you. For the mountain shall depart. Thank you. And the hills shall remove, but my kindness, God's kindness, his covenant loyalty shall not depart from me. Neither shall the covenant of my peace be removed, saith the Lord, which have mercy on thee. Why? Because the vine of the earth, Jesus, was cast into the great winepress of the wrath of God. And it was outside the city, referring to his crucifixion. Glory to God. Oh, I want to get into the blood. 1,600 furlongs. You know all that stuff's in there for a reason? But let me tell you something. It's hid from people that are not interested. But you come to a church where you're interested, and so am I. Amen? I want to know everything I look at in the Bible. What does that mean? What does that mean? Since I've learned there's only one message, Jesus Christ and him crucified, it just keeps opening up and up and up and up. And I'm thinking, oh my, now I see what that means. See, anytime the plumb line of scripture is Jesus Christ and Him crucified. You know what a plumb line is? That means you have a line. And if that line's off and you build, Roger knows, and the wall's like this, right? But a plumb line shows you He is. All right, now go to Psalm 85. I can see I'm not making real great time, but that's okay. We got to get this, guys. This is so good. Once you start getting it, man, you just keep getting it. All right, mercy and truth are met together. Righteousness and peace have kissed each other. How many of you read verses like this? They mean nothing to you. Anybody else besides me? Right? But you know, this is really powerful. And I'm going to show you how powerful it is. You know the word mercy, right? Should be loving kindness would be a better translation. It's hasid. Here's what it is. It's God manifesting His covenant loyalty in my life. I'll say that again. It's God manifesting that He's loyal to His covenant, which is Jesus, in my life. Now look at this. Mercy, covenant loyalty, and truth are met together. Righteousness and peace. Right standing with God, being in tune with God, and peace. Peace with God have kissed each other. Go to the next verse. Truth shall spring out of the earth. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father but by me, the great vine of the earth. Truth shall spring out of the earth. I hope you can see this. And righteousness shall look down from heaven. Oh, my. Glory to God. Keep going. Yea, the Lord shall give that which is good, and our land shall yield her increase. Increase is a blessing. Don't let anybody tell you any different. Next verse. Righteousness shall go before him. Give me the New American Standard, if you don't mind. Righteousness will go before him and will make his footsteps into a way. Isn't that awesome? This is because God kept the covenant through Jesus for you and I. Isn't that awesome? The representative that we needed is in Him. All right, hang with me. There's so much. I know what you're thinking. I'll just land the plane here and I'll do it because it's not fair to not do it. Back to Revelation 14. Remember, loving kindness, mercy, and truth are met together. Righteousness and peace have kissed each other. Truth shall spring out of the earth, and righteousness shall look down from heaven. You know what that's saying? God's saying, I connected you guys through my Son. But it's only through His Son. That's why so many things in this life want you to get off of His Son into other things. That's why we got to watching too much news. I get mad. Anybody else? You listen, focus on Him. You know what the walk of faith is about really is it's just a fight against distractions. And you don't fight against distractions by fighting against the distractions. You focus on faith, on Jesus, on who He is. That's very simple what I said, but it's very powerful. Go to the next verse, the great winepress of the wrath of God. Let me show you. The winepress was trodden outside the city. Let's go to Hebrews 13, 9 from the Amplified. I'm going to finish this quick. I am. We are landing. We'll carry this into the next week's outline. Do not be carried about by different and varied and alien teachings. Alien from what? From God through Jesus. Alien. See, this book was written to Jewish believers, Hebrew believers, listen, who were being tempted to renounce faith in Jesus to go back under the Sinaitic or Mosaic covenant. That's the context of the book. So don't be carried about, thank you, by these different and varied and alien teachings. For it is good for the heart to be established and ennobled and strengthened by means of grace. Glory to God. God's favor and spiritual blessings, and not to be devoted to foods. Dietary, old covenant, dietary rules and regulations. Rules of diet and ritualistic meals, which bring no spiritual benefit or profit to those who observe them. Next verse. We have an altar. We have an altar. We have an altar from which those who serve and worship in the tabernacle under the old covenant, they have no right to eat. Remember, Jesus said, except you eat my flesh and drink my blood, John chapter 6, you have no part in me. Next verse. For when the blood of animals is brought into the sanctuary by the high priest as a sacrifice for sin, the victim's bodies are burned outside the limits of the camp or outside the city. The great vine of the earth was outside the city. This is talking, I'm going to show you, it's about Jesus. Next verse. Therefore, Jesus also suffered and died outside, here it is, the city's gates, in order that he might purify and consecrate the people through the shedding of his own blood and set them apart as holy for God. Look at your neighbor and say, you're holy. That means set apart. That means other people are depressed, you're blessed. Other people have no peace, you have peace. Other people, hearts are failing them for seeing the things that are coming upon the earth, but you're trusting in him. Okay, look at the next verse. Let us then go forth from all that would prevent us to him outside the camp at Calvary, bearing the contempt and abuse and shame with him. Next verse. For here on this earth, we have no permanent city. Everything we have on the earth is for the glory of the kingdom. You brought nothing in this earth, you'll take nothing out. You've never seen a hearse pulling a U-Haul. For here we have no permanent city, but we're looking for the one which is to come. Our focus is on eternal things, and everything we have here, we're using in light of eternity. Now go to the next verse. I'm going to finish this. Through him, Jesus, therefore, let us constantly and at all times offer up to God a sacrifice of praise. Let us praise him for what? For his sacrifice, which is the fruit of our lips. Well, I don't believe in that. Well, you need to read the Bible. Which is the fruit of our lips that thankfully acknowledge and confess and glorify his name. You can tell what people believe by what's coming out of their mouth. And if you're really focused on him, you're going to be a praiser. Glory be to God. Well, I'm waiting till everything's perfect, and then I'm going to praise the Lord. How's that working for you? I'm waiting till Joel don't try to kill flies on our window, and then I'll be happy. How's that working for me? Just kidding, Joel. Now back to Revelation 14, verse 20. And we'll land the plane. Revelation chapter 14 and verse 20. And the winepress, remember Jesus, the vine of the earth, was cast into the winepress of the wrath of God. That's why it says wrath abides on those who don't believe. Why? Because the covenant's been broken through Adam. The winepress was trod without the city with the blood of Jesus. And blood came out of the winepress, even under the horse bridles by the space of 1,600 furlongs. Now, why is all this language here? I'm going to give you the quick one. Everybody say furlongs. Furlongs is stadion in Greek, and here's what it means. It's a race course. It's a race course. Remember what it says? That we're in a race? 1 Corinthians 9, Hebrews chapter 12. Let us run with patience the race that is set before us. Remember that? Right? So this, look at this. A furlong means it's a race course. It's a place in which running contests were held with the one who outstripped the rest and reached the goal first received the prize. How many of you know Jesus outstripped all principalities and powers and he reached the goals and obtained the prize? This isn't talking about your blood, it's talking about his. He's the one that was crucified outside the city. He's the one that was put into the great winepress of the wrath of God. He didn't deserve it, but he deserved it for us. He became sin. He didn't carry sin, he became it. So that you and I, who were not righteous, could become the righteousness of God in him. Well, what about 1,600 furlongs? Okay, this is going to be quick. I'm just kidding. I'm going to give you two meanings of the number 1,000. A metaphor. This is symbolic. That's what I'm looking for. 1,000. 1,000 is a number of infinity. Look at it. I'm just going to give it to you two places. Psalm 50, verse 10 says, God owns the cattle on 1,000 hills, right? Does that mean when you get to the 1,001st hill, God doesn't own that cow? No, it's a number of infinity. Psalm 84, verse 10 says, better is one day in your courts than 1,000 anywhere else. Does that mean that 1,001st day is better somewhere else than in the presence of God? Absolutely not. And let me show you another one. It's a number of infinity, but it's also a number of wholehearted devotion. Go to 1 Kings 3:3. I'm trying to fly. I am really trying to land. Keep your seat belts on. Tray tables up. Seat forward. Okay, and Solomon loved the Lord, walking in the statutes of David his father. Only he sacrificed and burnt incense in the high places. Next verse. And the king went to Gibeon to sacrifice there, for that was the great high place. Look what he sacrificed. 1,000 burnt offerings did Solomon offer upon the water. Now we could go down. This is where God spoke to him and said, ask what you will in this context here. But notice what he offered. 1,000 burnt offerings. 1,000 is also a symbolic number of total dedication to God. But you know, our dedication to God is not based on our dedication. It's based on faith in his dedication to us. See, that's the key to faith. Now look at this. Burnt offerings. I'm not really taught on the offerings, but a burnt offering was a voluntary offering, and it was an offering of total dedication. Hence the reason it was burnt, or the whole burnt offering. This is a number of total dedication. So 1,000 speaks of unending total dedication that God has to you and I because of his blood. What about 600? I thought you'd never ask. All right, let's go to Revelation chapter 14, verse 20. Go there quick. We'll just let that up there so people can see it. Look at it. It says, 1,000 by the space of the blood, the winepress of the wrath of God under the horse bridles. I want to get into the horse bridles and get into Adi, but we're not going to do that right now. That's an Old Testament Hebrew word. By the space of 1,000, watch this, in 600 furlongs. 600, I studied this number. Are you ready? 600 signifies a balanced relationship with family. Because of God's dedication to me, I can be dedicated to you. I was listening to a powerful covenant preacher, Malcolm Smith, this morning on my run, and he was talking about how smudgy he used to be. He would tell people, he said, all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. You know, with this smugness like I haven't, you know what the glory of God is? You know how we come short of the glory of God? We don't love people with the same agape love, unconditional love that God has for us. Anytime I don't love you with the agape love of God, I'm coming short of the glory of God. This is what's in us. Look at this. The winepress was trodden without the city. 1,600 for 600 has to do with, it signifies abandoned relationship with family. It's harmonious love. It's family life. It's a period of joy and stability in the company of loved ones. It's people who resonate with this number are usually family oriented. Spiritual, it has to do with spiritual development, balance, home, and family stability. Now, what's that primary family? The family of God. I say this all the time. People say, I just love God, but I can't stand people. You don't love God. You cannot love God and hate people. You cannot love God and live separate from his people. That's hard. 1 John 3, we're landing. God, I didn't even get to that. We will get into it next week because I want to lay this out. I want to get into the covenant steps. They're awesome. What'd I say? 1 John 3. What verse did I say? Verse 19. We'll start there. And hereby we know. Look at verse 18. Yes. My little children, let us not love in word, neither in tongue, but in deed and in truth. Verse 19. And hereby, or here's how we know that we are of the truth and shall assure our hearts before him. Now stop. Our hearts need to be assured. Our hearts need to be assured. Not just our head. See, often we mistake information in the head for revelation in the heart, and they're different. We need information in the head, but if it doesn't change my heart, it's just information. Even good information. Okay, next verse. For if our heart condemn us, you know your heart can condemn you? That's why when people say your heart and your spirit are the same thing, that's incorrect. Your heart is your entire inner man, which is your spirit and your soul. Don't have time to go into that, but I refer you to, for example, Hebrews 4:12. But if our heart condemns, God's greater than our heart and knows all things. So if your heart's condemning you, just rejoice that God's greater in your heart. You don't have to go with the verdict of your heart if you're in Christ. Next verse. Here, this is good. But I love this verse. Beloved, if our heart's not condemning us, there is therefore now no condemnation to those that are in Christ who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. Beloved, if our heart condemn us not, then have we confidence toward God. This is why you got to get this covenant stuff. I sit there and find myself looking, well, I'm not this, I'm not that. I should be this, I should be better here. And that's the ploy of the enemy. I'm dead and my life is hid with Christ in God, Colossians 3:3. Whew, glory. Next verse. We're talking about, and whatsoever we ask, we receive of him. Why? because we keep his commandments, plural. Oh, there you go. Back under the law, that's not what he's saying. I'm going to prove it to you right here. It's not the 613 commandments that make up the old covenant law. There's one twofold commandment. Here he says commandments, plural. And do those things that are pleasing in his sight. Okay, now watch this. We're walking in agreement with who we are. And this is his commandment, singular. Wait a minute, I thought it was commandments, plural. No, it's singular, but it is plural. One twofold commandments. Here it is. Here it is, guys. Here's the new covenant. The very first one, that we should believe on the name of his son, Jesus Christ. Now, this is not devil faith. You know, the demons believe. You believe there's one God, you do well. The devils believe and tremble, it says in James 2:19, right? This is not just acknowledging the existence of God. This is putting your faith in his son, Jesus, as your covenant with God. Whew. Golly, I say these things and I'm thinking, it blows my mind that God made a covenant with his creation. That God, I'm telling you, God loves me. I'm going to boast and brag on his love for me. He is head over heels in love with me. He carries my picture in his wallet, as Andrew says. Now, there's a mantle in heaven that's got my picture there. And he's doctored it up so I actually look good. And this is his commandment singular, that we should believe on the name of his son, Jesus Christ. I thought it was commandment and commandments. Here's the second part of it. And love, back to verse 23. And love one another as he gave us commandment. How did he give us commandment? Anybody know? How did he give us commandment? All right, jump over to John 13, 34 and 35. This is how he gave us commandment. Here it is. John 13, verse 34 and 35. 34, thank you. A new commandment I give you. This is how he commanded us to love one another. Notice it's not an additional commandment. It's not an addendum or an add-on to the Mosaic law. No, it's a new one. Everybody say new. I give you that you love one another as yourself, as I have loved you. Wow, that I say the same. That you also love one another. Go to the next verse. By this shall all men know that you're my disciples, if you love one another. This is why Satan loves offense. Satan would love nothing more than to get you and I offended and pull away from the body of Christ. You know what I've learned about the body of Christ and continue to learn? People are still people. And I don't care if their flesh is USDA choice flesh, it's still flesh. And they're capable of being as goofy as, so am I. So am I, and so are you. Don't, you all started amen and when I said about me, but now I'm saying about you, the amens got quieter. And this is why you need to constantly hear this. Marinate in this. I'm constantly marinating in the fact that I'm in a covenant with God through Jesus, and it cannot be violated. It cannot be broke. The only way God can deny me is if he denies his son. God's moving. I have this dream. What is my dream? To fulfill my God-ordained purpose in this life at every level, as a dad, as a minister, as a father, as all these things. I want to fulfill the reason God put me here, and so do you. But it's only as you relate to him through Jesus. I got a guy. I'm just going to say it, and I'll close with this. A good friend of mine. Awesome, awesome man of God. And we're supposed to hopefully talk this week. And I've had this question before. Are you ready for it? Here it is. You ready? Hold on to your seat. It's deep. Wants to talk about tithing. You know how many times that question comes up? Do you know why? Usually, I can't say in every case, but usually it's because people have been abused with tithing. There's people think, I don't believe in tithing. I think it's the biblical place to start. I don't think you have to tithe. I think you get to. I don't think God's mad at you if you don't. I think you need a revelation. And so in every area. But for years I heard that if I didn't give a tithe, that Malachi 3, that I was cursed with a curse, that I had robbed God. You are not cursed with a curse. If you're born again, the curse of the law, Jesus fulfilled that curse of the law. I can never be cursed. But people can curse you. And it usually comes from things like this called pulpits. They put you under an approach to God that's outside of Jesus. Oh, I can tell you're ready to land. Okay, lots more. But we're gonna roll this into the next outline. And I want to get it because there's stuff I want to get into next week. Hopefully we'll get right on it and get into it next week. But the more you see it, the more you see it. The less you see it, the less you'll see it. As a good friend of mine said yesterday, Free people, free people. Just like hurt people, free people, free people. When you see your freedom in Christ, a lot of people don't even know what that means. Bless God, I'm free. That's what they think it is. You know what freedom is? It's free to be who you are in Christ. For example, I love to get in the Word. That's part of, you know, it's my job and all that stuff too, but I love it. I mean, constantly. That's who I am in Christ. Does that make any sense? So I'm free to be who I am in Him. I don't know if you can hear that, but that's pretty good. And so are you. You know, God's put desires in your heart. And God's put things in your heart. And sometimes we're afraid, well, if I like it, it must not be God. If I really get serious about God, He's going to send me to the jungles or wherever. Listen, if God sends you to the jungles or wherever, you'll want to go. He'll put that desire in your heart and think, every time I talk to them, they want to go to the jungles of Bolivia or wherever. Because that's what God put in you. God is good. He's not, is the word I'm looking for, sadistic? He's not like, ha, 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 ha. Listen, he could have, I still don't understand when Moses said, God told Moses, get out of the way, I'll destroy them all and make a great people out of you. And Moses stood there in the gap. Isn't that amazing? So we don't realize how powerful covenant is. We still think, this is why people's word don't mean anything. This is why people can go on and lie about the president and lie about leaders and say all kinds of things. It doesn't mean anything. This is why people don't understand words. Your word is your covenant. Jesus became the word. When I give you my word, it should mean my, hey, I'll die before I don't fulfill this to you. Hallelujah, that's good stuff. Praise God, I'm going to land. Amen. Give the Lord a hand. Yes, amen. We're going to get into some really, really, really good things, and I'm